Hi everyone and welcome to Ombarus Does the Complete Roguelike Story Hole Part 4 and 5. If you're new here, I'm following this tutorial series on the subreddit RoguelikeDev along with many other great people, and we're all here to help each other, so don't hesitate to go on Reddit, post your progress, or ask questions in the comments below this video. I'll be happy to do my best to answer all and every one of you. And also check out my previous episodes in the playlist above so that you can follow with all the other parts that I've gone through up till now. Now, in part 4 this week, we're going to be tackling the FOV and the map memory. Luckily, libdecode already comes with a library full of algorithms for computing the field of view, so we're not going to start from scratch, but we'll still need to define a couple of configurations to use in our program. In this case, I'm defining radius, which is the distance of the player view circle, and then I had something called light walls, is to tell the algorithm whether or not I want the walls next to floors to be illuminated, to be in the list of visible tiles. We'll also add a few more colors to the configuration we added in the last episode, because we want to be able to visualize the area the player can see by changing a little bit the background color of our view area, or our lit area, if you will. And finally, since calculating the field of view can become a little bit expensive, it's a good idea to not do it every frame, but only do it when necessary, so we'll add a variable to check if the player has moved and it's important to recalculate the light, otherwise we'll avoid doing it for no reason. Now, the FOV algorithm configuration is a little bit more interesting. Without digging into the details of how each algorithm calculates the visible area around the player, it's interesting to know what kind of behavior these algorithms are going to have on the shadowed space created by the objects blocking the view of the player. So if you look at the page I'm showing you right now, depending on the type of game you have in mind, you might want to use one or another type of these algorithm. As you can see, they behave differently depending on if these are a corner, or if it's a diagonal, or if it's a column, or it's a hallway or something. And each of those have a few drawbacks and a few qualities that might make it interesting for your game depending on what you're trying to achieve. But no matter the algorithm you choose for your game, remember that there's nothing stopping you from going back after calculating the result and improving them with your own filtering afterwards. Next, we'll make a new script to keep all our FOV methods together, and we'll start with the initialization of the map array in libdecode. Now, whenever I'm accessing new methods from the library, I like to go check the documentation to see exactly how it works. Remember, this is a tutorial, we want to learn some more about the library and get more familiar with the code. So when I was looking at the documentation for the method set properties that's specified in the tutorial, I kind of noticed a little warning there. So, like I said in my previous episode, if you want to learn from its tutorial, it's not enough to just blindly follow what's written on it. You need to think about the implication, and in this case, I think it's probably a good idea to ignore the tutorial and try to replace the setProperty method with the array that's specified in the documentation. Now that we've initialized the map, all we need is to call the compute FOV method. So we'll make a second method in our script to call the compute FOV method from libdecode, and to compute the tiles that are visible from the player point of view, we're going to pass all the parameters we've set up before in the engine.py. And once again, looking at the documentation, it clearly says that the way the tutorial does it is deprecated, so I went ahead and I tried to use the new method that's recommended from the documentation. Of course, trying to do something new, everything broke, so I spent some time trying to fix what was wrong and the errors I was getting. First, I thought I'd fix it by not using my brain, so I thought, oh, it's going over the max index range, so I'll just do a -1 and everything will be fixed. Well, of Of course it won't. I mean, I knew that range already does from 0 to max minus 1, so like I knew it wasn't going to be the fix, but my brain was off at that time. Still, after playing around with it a little bit and taking the time to actually understand what was happening, I realized pretty quickly that the reason it was going over the max array size was because I flipped my x and my y. I don't know why the new methods take y as a parameter first and then x, but once I flipped those around, everything looked like it was working fine. But of course, I didn't have any visual yet because we haven't updated our render function to show the tiles that are highlighted. So to make sure that everything is working, the next step is going into the render function and updating the code that colors the background with the information in the map and use the new colors we defined before in the configuration array so that we can see the result of the compute FOV method that we called. Again, it seems that map is in FOV is a deprecated version, so I'll try to figure out how to update the code so it uses the new map.fov array that the documentation suggests we use. I also think it's maybe a little bit better to use it like that because honestly, having a method that receives the map as a parameter and then has to dig inside the information of the map to return the value I want kind of breaks the encapsulation that we like usually in object-oriented programming. So this way seems a little bit cleaner to me anyways. So where before we checked only if it was a wall or a floor, now we kind of duplicate the code and we change the color based on not only if it's a wall or a floor, but also if this wall or floor is in the lit area from the algorithm computing the field of view. Now, I agree that this if condition is probably not the most beautiful in the world, but yeah, if we ever have to come back to it, maybe we can improve it. And it's time again for another quick test, and obviously looking at it, something is very wrong. But if you take the time to look at what's happening, actually, I think you can figure out what's wrong. Obviously, I don't know what is true and false anymore, because I flipped the values when I was initializing the map, and that's why the walls are floor and the floors are walls. So after fixing this little mistake, now we can see that wherever the character walks, it's lit up, and then we can move between the rooms, and the rooms are going to light up like it should, and it's really nice. Speaking of seeing, now it would be a good time to try to hide the NPCs when they're outside the line of sight of the character. And we're going to do this by just skipping the rendering of the entity whenever he's not on a tile that's considered lit by the algorithm. And even though our NPC is not always realistically positioned because it's just hard-coded right now, when he happens to be inside a room, we can quickly do a test to see that he's actually changing visibility based on whether or not he's within the line of sight of the character, and it seems like it's working, so let's get to the next step. Now the last step in part 4 is doing what I call the map discovery, because normally in a roguelike you don't know the whole layout of the map until you've explored it. And we'll do this by playing in the rendering method again and skipping the rendering for the background tiles that we've never seen. And to remember the tiles that we've seen, we're just going to go back into the tile class and we're going to add this explored property and we'll initialize it to false. So when this property is false, we skip the rendering, and when the property is true, we render it as the dark remembered background. And maybe you ask, when do we set it to true? Well, we set it to true when it's been lit at least once. So what we're going to do is that when we render the lit tile, we're going to tag them as explored at the same time so that when it comes out of the lit area, it's going to be rendered as a remembered background in the dark blue kind of colors we chose for it. And that's it. I'm actually pretty impressed. I mean, we got a lot done for this little part of the tutorial, and we can now explore the dungeon, enemy shows up when we see them, and all of this with just a few lines of code. Good job, and it's looking pretty good. But now that part 4 is done, it's time to go to part 5, and part 5 is gonna be maybe a little bit less exciting, because it's gonna be about setting down the foundation of more complex entities and AI in our dungeon, because if you remember, right now we have only one hard-coded NPC that sometimes spawns inside wall, and that's not really what we want. So let's improve, let's level up our NPC generation algorithm. First, we'll start by adding a new method in the game map to place random entities in all the rooms. And I think it makes sense to put it in the game map class because it's part of the whole map generation where we'll spawn the creatures that live inside the dungeon. But it's also a good place to put it because it's going to be easy to look at the data and know if we're inside a room or not. And also it's worth noting that this method is definitely something that we're going to visit again and again and again and keep improving, because as we add more monsters, our rule for spawning them are going to get more and more complex. We're going to have to be checking the player level and the level of the monster and how deep we are in the dungeon, and we might have special rooms that spawn special monsters and so on. So it's something we're going to keep adding on all the time. But for now, let's just keep with the basic. For each room, we are going to roll a dice to decide how many monsters will be in this room, and we're going to roll another dice to decide which of the two types of monster we're going to have right now. And finally, we roll two more dice based on the width and the height of the room to find a position for our little monsters. And then, once this monster has been generated, we add him to the list of entities. And to run this method, the best place to do it is when we're actually generating the rooms. So after we've generated the room, we're just going to put a call to place entities, and it's going to generate the monster for each of those rooms. And also, now that we have actual monsters in our game, we can go back into engine.py and remove the hard-coded NPC. We just leave the player because he's kind of a special character, and now we're good to test and see if it works. And as you can see, that's pretty cool. We move around and there's monster in each of the rooms, and that's really nice. But if you notice, there's a little something a bit strange when we go over the monsters. Well, first of all, our character is going to disappear under the monster, but also in a roguelike, normally monsters should be blocking the way. You shouldn't be able to just go over them without bumping into them or something. For this part of the tutorial, we're going to fix the bumping first. For this, we need a few more attributes in our entity class. Mainly, we're going to give them a name, and we're going to add a boolean to know if it's blocking or not. Now, why not block for all entities? Well, remember that entities are also going to be used for items on the ground, and these might not block the player, but also we might one day want a monster that might be like a ghost or something, and the player could go through him. So it's good to have it as a property so that we can just check if it's blocking or not. Now that we have these properties, we can create a new method that will loop over all the entities in the map and check if one of them is blocking a given tile. And now, if you remember, in engine.py, before moving the player, we're already doing a check to see if the destination is a floor tile or a wall, and if it's a wall, we just skip the move altogether. Well, we're going to just expand this if and check also if the tile the player is going to contain an entity with its blocking property true. I was playing around a little bit with the structure of this condition because I wanted to make sure that we first check the wall, because this is really quick to test, and if we're hitting a wall, where we're definitely not getting an entity, so we can just skip the rest of the check. Because get blocking entities loops over all the entities, and if you have a map with, I don't know, 5,000 entities, it could get a little bit slow. So to avoid this, I wanted to make sure that this is really the last check we do when we're moving the character. And just remember, we're going to use bumping as a way to fight monsters too at some point, or to pick up items. So we want to add a quick print to make sure that we're actually detecting the collision, and it's going to be a good way to test until we've implemented all those features. And okay, now there's a few typo, fix here, fix there, and so on. And now we can test the game and we see that we can bump into the monsters and the prints are working and our collisions system is kind of working. Now, before we can improve our AI and make them do stuff, we're going to have to introduce the system of turn. And right now the only thing that can act is the player, because we have no concept of turn. So we need to start implementing our turn-based system. And this is another rabbit hole in roguelike dev. I mean, there's infinite discussion to have about how to do a proper turn-based system. And you can read about it all you want, but for our case, since it's a tutorial, we're just going to implement a us versus them system. So for now, we're going to create a new game state script, and in this state, we're going to keep two variables, player turn and enemy turn. And then in engine.py, we'll add a new game state variable and we'll initialize it to player turn. And since right now there's pretty much only one thing the player can do, we'll add a check just before moving to make sure that it's the player's turn, otherwise we won't let him move. And when he actually does his move, we're going to switch the turn to the enemy and we're going to set the game state to enemy turn after the player has moved. Of course, we want to add something for the AI to do on their turn so that they can loop and give back the control to the player at some point. So what we're going to do right now is just a simple loop. And for their action, we're just going to put some print and that's it. We'll assume that the AI has acted and we'll just return the control to the player after we've looped over all the entities. Now, as we run the game and test our new turn system, we can see that every time the player moves, then all the AI are going to print their little comments and it's going to come back to the player turn. But actually, I think that's a little bit too spammy. So just for fun, I'm going to derail from the tutorial a little bit and I'm going to add a check before printing the message to make sure that the NPC that's saying it is visible to the character. So basically only what we see, we can hear. And now when we test it, it's really nice because we can move around the dungeon and when we see a monster, we can see them talking to each other or something. And then when they go out of sight, then we stop hearing them, but they're still acting and still doing their turn. But in the background, we don't see them because they're not in our line of sight. And that's pretty good. And with this, we've completed part 5 of the tutorial. So that's going to be it for this week. Stay tuned next week for part 6 and 7. And for now, stay safe. See you all in my next episode. Bye.